Psalms chapter 95. God in presence, looking to the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah. I know they're not looking for the Jesus Christ, but this is a premillennial statement. As we're looking for Jesus Christ to come before the tribulation, so were they looking for the Messiah before the tribulation. You get that? And Jesus showed up before the tribulation period. Tribulation hasn't happened. He's come. But he said he's going to come again for the church, what we call the rapture. So this Psalm 95 is, you read it with the Jews standing before the Messiah, and it only can be in a millennium. It can't be the first advent. Yeah, one time they were, Hosanna, Hosanna, greatest and the highest. And not even a week later, crucify him. Why? Because he didn't conquer the Roman government. They wanted Jesus to put Pilate and Herod and all them down so they can have the land. Oh, come. Let us sing unto the Lord. You sing unto the Lord? Or are your songs questionable that it could be to anybody? Can we take the lyrics of your song or hymn, whatever you want to call it, and could we hand it to a lover? And could they take that as, oh, you wrote that to me? Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Now, to Israel, that rock was a rock that gave them water, that followed them in the wilderness, the Bible tells us. Had they not had that flinty rock of water, there would have been no salvation, because man needs air, and second, he needs water. And God provided him with water. You can't have a city, go in a desert somewhere, and find a city where they... Oh, wait a minute. Well, let me say this, and I'll say what counteracts it. You can't go in a desert in a normal world and find a city that there's no water. Only stupid America can you go in the middle of a city where there's no water and have Las Vegas. Where you gotta pump water away so you can lose your money on the one-eyed bandits. You know, if you were to cut off that pipeline that goes to Las Vegas, Las Vegas would be gone. It'd die up, shrivel up. Let us come before his presence. Before his presence. There he is. And Ezekiel speaks about going up certain time of the years and going before the Lord. And he gives an illustration that if Egypt doesn't go up, there'll be no rain, there'll be famine. With thanksgiving. Was it Nehemiah that said, oh, I was sad in the king's presence and his life was in danger? You don't go up before Jesus Christ and move.
I'm being hurt. Oh, I had to walk all the way here. Ow.
You don't go like the Lord like that. You go, yeah, amen, glory to God. You did that in some churches today. They fall over in the pews waking up from the sleepiness that they do from the boring preaching they get. Joyfulness, thanksgiving, make a joyful noise to him with psalms. What church sings psalms? I will sing of the Lord, whatever we, that's, that, what is it, Psalm 91? Yeah, but that's only one line. How come the whole psalm ain't put to music? How come more of the psalm? Hey, you want to read a psalm, you want to read Psalm 119, sing it. For the Lord is a great God, a great King, capital K. Who's the king? What does his vesture say when he comes? There's the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that "and" doesn't mean that you have chocolate M&M's and you got peanut M&M's. Okay? That's two different M&M's. That's, you got, when we went to, you get soft ice cream, you can get vanilla and chocolate. It's together. It's one ice cream. And that's, read that verse to a Jehovah Witness and see how you interpret the "and." You know, you say, "Mr. and Mrs. such and such." Well, according to the Bible, they are one flesh. How about that? So here we have Psalm 95. We have God and Jesus Christ, the King, as one. And the King, capital K, King of Kings. Look at the capital letter on that one. Look on the small letter K on that one. Above all gods. In his hand, the God and the King. His hand, doesn't say hands, doesn't say their hands, his hand as one, are the deep places of the earth. You know, I don't know what they call them, but when I've seen the pictures of the Titanic, there's little white crabs or something down there. God knows how many of those white crabs are down there, walking all around this luxurious ship. Man has got to have special things to go down there and look at, and only at a limited time. You know, they go down there bottom of the oceans, they find the most beautiful, colorful things ever to be found. Why? Because God's omnipresence. Man may have never seen them, but God sees them. And the deep places of the earth, what deeper can you get than hell in Abraham's bosom? Walking across the gulf? Who did that? The Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, if you go to some churches, they say, no, Jesus didn't go to hell. Huh? False doctrine. The strength of the hills is his also. That means that Jesus Christ, that God, is creator. The sea is his. Genesis 1:10. You ever know anybody that tried to sell the sea? Because it's his. He made it. H2O. His hands formed the dry land. Genesis 1. Creator, Jesus Christ, God, were there. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. His presence again before the Lord. There he is in Jerusalem. There he is upon the throne. You come to him and you kneel down. And you acknowledge him as Creator, your Maker. So what is the thing they say, you know, our Maker? Where did they get that from? The King James Bible. For he is our God. Can the Jew say that today? Can a Jewish Jew, you say, why did you say Jewish Jew? Because there's other people out there who think they're Jewish and they're not. No, a Jew cannot say he is our God. Individual. Remember, Jews are not corporate today. An individual Jew has a choice to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ or not. Not the nation. It is not the nation unto Jacob's trouble. The Jew as a corporate body, as a nation, is broken apart today to receive Christ individually or not. There's no difference between Jew and the Gentile or heathen. I forget which one it says. The only way that he can be, that God can be his God today, is belief on the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Didn't Jesus even deal with them? You know, if you were Abraham's children, you would obey, you would do. And Paul writes about if you were Abraham's children, circumcised, what does that do? Who cares? So what? You're circumcised. So what? You're Abraham. I mean, Abraham. Paul says, I'm of the stock of Israel. I'm of Benjamin. A Pharisee of Pharisees. So what? What did that have anything to do? It didn't count to I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. We are the people of his pasture. Run back to John chapter 10. There's the sheep. In the millennium. In eternity. And the sheep of his hand. John chapter 10. Primary, except for there's one verse, I forget, it's like in the 20s in John chapter 10. Other sheep I have. That's us. But primarily, when you talk about sheep and the people as people, it's referencing to the Jews. When Jesus told Peter, feed my sheep and feed my lambs, he was not talking about the Gentiles. Because who were the first people that Peter preached to? Jews at Pentecost. Did the heathen celebrate Pentecost? No. And the sheep at his hand, today, if you will hear his voice, run back to John chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 3, 7 through 11. Harden not your heart. Now that is good to use for soul winning. You can spiritualize. I can say on the street, today if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. But doctrinally, where does it stand? To Israel. As into the provocation. Resentment. To incite anger. That's what provocation means. And the Holy Spirit is going to give you more information. As in the day of temptation in the wilderness. They resented God and they excited anger in the wilderness. That is not, and you can apply that today, that is not the response God wants from you. Have you ever told anybody about the Lord Jesus Christ and got an angry resentment, excited anger response from them? That is not what God wants. And yet the Bible tells you, harden not your heart. When they react like that, their heart is being hardened. So, you deal with somebody who gets angry with God. All right, what does Romans 10 say about the heart and salvation? With the heart, man believes on the righteousness, right? If this verse says, harden not your heart as a provocation, they're angry, they resent. Would you properly go and say, okay, now say this prayer to be saved? You see? You see the danger? If they're angry with you, they're not angry with you, they're angry with God, the scriptures say. As in the day in the temptation in the wilderness. You need to study Israel in the wilderness, because even Paul brings it up to the Corinthian church, the carnal church, and their actions and their conduct and what they did, because what they did, you're going to see people do. And what was Moses' response? Prayer. And he got angry. Don't you go philosophical with me. Oh, I never get angry at people. I deal with. No, no, no. Moses did. And he had a great, vast majority of a congregation than you will ever get. So again, we're learning from the wilderness. You need to study the Old Testament. Don't bypass it. We've done from Genesis 1 to Psalms 95. We've learned a lot of things. Harden not your heart in the day of provocation as in the day of temptation in the wilderness. When your fathers, okay, let me ask you a question now. Is that written to Gentiles? No. I said, listen, today if you hear his voice, harden not your... That sounds great when you're witnessing to people. And you go run to Hebrews chapter... What? What's the name of the book? Hebrews. The fathers... I'm trying to help you people. I'm trying to rightly divide the scripture. Your fathers tempted me. That is not Gentiles. Hebrews is not written to Gentiles. The title itself tells you who it's written to. There are certain books that are a danger when you go run to. Hebrews, Acts, and Matthew. Transition books. Hebrews is a letter written to Hebrews. And it says, your fathers, Jewish, tempted me, God. Also Jesus Christ. Proved me. God provided all their temptations. He gave them water. He gave them food. He gave them signs to prove who Moses was. And saw my work. So again, if somebody comes up to you, oh, let me see God. And I've had people tell me that. That's what I'm saying. Israel saw God. Israel saw the works. They tempted God. God proved them. God took care, and they still rejected him. Those people still died in the wilderness. Except for Joshua and Caleb. And then Aaron's sons there, Phinehas, I believe it was. And I can't remember the other son's name. That got in the promised land. 40 years long was I grieved with this generation. Alright. What's Paul say about grieving? He says, grieve not the Holy Spirit, right? Well, I don't understand what grieving is. Or to grieve the Holy Spirit. Go back and study the Jews in the wilderness. Because God said they grieved me. And is the Holy Spirit God? And is God the Holy Spirit? Their actions will show you what to the extent of grieving God and the Holy Spirit is. There was no faith. There was no trust. There was a complete lustfulness. And it was overtaken trying to overdo God's power. Forty years long was I agree with this generation. That 40 long period that you read. What does Deuteronomy say? The first three verses of the book. And it was 11 days journey from Cages Barnea to something. But in the 40th year. Wait a minute. It was only 11 days journey. It took them 40 years. And it's not because Jewish husbands would not stop and ask for directions. Why did it take 40 years? Because they grieved God. All right, I'm a Christian. I'm getting nowhere in my Christian walk. You may be grieving the Holy Spirit. You better have some growth. You got to have the manna, the Word of God. You got to have the water from the rock. I am the living water. It is a people that do err, or err. I don't like that word. I can never get it right. In their heart. H-E-A-R-T. If they don't get salvation in their heart, Romans 10, 9, and 10, they have erred and they will die and go to hell no matter how much they know. Saying this prayer does not enter into the heart. It goes in the ears. All right, I am saying what you're saying. It is coming out the mouth. You don't even have to. You know, another thing too is they don't do it verbally. But it says with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. If you don't believe in what God has told you from the heart, it is not right. And they have not known my ways. Unless you believe with the heart with righteousness, you don't have the way, the truth, and the life. They knew nothing about God because it was not in their heart to know God. Why did the Jews crucify Christ, the Messiah, and then in the book of Acts not even acknowledge him as Messiah? Because it wasn't in the heart. It was in the lust. Lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and the lust of the eyes. Why does a man reject Jesus Christ today and go to hell? Because they have erred in the heart. They'd rather do something else. They're darkness. They're that cockroach I preach about on the street. You turn the lights on in the kitchen and boom, he's gone. He don't want to hear anything from you. And when you bring that light, John speaks about in John chapter 1, to a darkened heart, they've got two responses. Boom, they're gone. They don't want to hear it. Or they're sitting there like, oh, that's trying to see it loose. And don't expect them to get that way right away, because guess what? You've been in darkness and you get this light, it's going to hurt. That's planting seed. That seed had a little bit of light, didn't it? Then you put it back down in the dirt and bury it and you wait for the water. Then it pops up through the soil and gets light and then bears fruit. But these people erred because they grieved God. They resented God. Resenting and excite anger against God is err or err in their heart. Like it says in Psalms, the fool has said in his heart. Why do you keep talking about heart? Because heart is the condition that man needs to be saved. I can tell you how to be saved, and you can have it in your itsy-bitsy brain. Okay, I know I need to be saved. But if it's not regenerated, it is not produced from your heart, you're not saved. Why am I stressing that? All those Jews that were in the wilderness, their heart was not right. They died and went to hell. And God took him out of the promised land. I mean, God took him out of Egypt. And he fed them. He gave them water. They were in the congregation, were they not? Would you agree with me that those were in the congregation with God's people? And how many people today are sitting in a congregation of a church that are eating, that are drinking, that rose up to play, and when they die, they'll end up in hell? Well, I was with that church. What happened? Your heart wasn't right. Well, God gave us water, God gave us food, and we bowed our head and thanked Him for it. Your heart wasn't right. Didn't we do this in your presence, Lord? Depart from me. I never knew you. You know, the rapture were to happen during church time, the church services of America will keep on going, some of them, and they wouldn't even know. Unto whom I, God, swear in my wrath. What is the wrath of God upon a sinner that rejects and that grieves Him? That is excited anger and resents God. What is that wrath? That they should not enter into my rest. Now go back and read Hebrews chapter 3 about the rest. Where did a Jew go that was right in the eyes of God? Did he go to heaven? No. He went to God's rest, Abraham's bosom. They didn't get the rest. Did they get rest in the land? No, they were fighting everybody because they did not obey what God told them to do. He told them to wipe out the Canaanites, all of them. Hittites, Hivites, and whatever you kites. Get rid of them. Did they get rest? Ask David. He was fighting them all. This is those things all the time. Had they done what they were supposed to do, David would never have had a war. There was no rest because they disobeyed God. Should not enter my rest. A man that rejects God, a man that will not get saved today, will not enter in God's rest. Absent from the body, be present with the Lord. Isn't that a rest? If you were to die before the rapture, your body, the Paul says, is sleeping. It's never going to sin again. You can park 14 Chryslers on top of that body, you ain't going to feel nothing. While you're present with the Lord Jesus Christ. If you are raptured, caught up when you're alive, that is rest. And then when you get that new body, and when the great white throne judgment is done and God wipes away our tears and all that, well, you want to talk about a rest? How about a rest eternally? Eternal, you do not need pain medicine. You don't need medical insurance, Mr. Obama, in eternity. But if you grieve the Holy Spirit and don't do what God tells you to do, what is the wrath of God? Lake of fire for all eternity. This song is for when Jesus Christ is on the throne in Jerusalem. And it looks like when it comes call time to go before Jesus Christ, there's a warning here. Do not resist God. Do not grieve God. Get going and get over there. Because again, Ezekiel says if Egypt doesn't come, you may still have that free will and say, I don't want to go. And there is the lake of fire. And we're talking about Jews. I don't know. I could be stretching that part. And if I am, I'll put it in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and ask him to forgive me for my sins. I'm not going to put that down doctrinally. But there is a thing that God and Jesus Christ is there as one. And there is a plea that, hey, don't be like your fathers. Do what God tells you to do. I'll state that fact right there. Jesus Christ is there. The Jews are to go and sing praises to him. They're to worship him. And the plea is, obey. Do not be like your fathers that did not obey. I'll leave it like that.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my